seems like now would be kind of a good time to enforce the value of respectful dialogue, even on controversial issues. I'm the president of Catholic Scholars of Delaware, and this debate is sponsored by Catholic Scholars and by the Philosophy Department. I have little sign-up sheets here for my students who are getting just a little tiny bit of extra credit because the issue of abortion came up in both of my classes. I also have a sign-up sheet for the Catholic Scholars email list, if anyone is interested in being on that. We send out, besides events that we're involved in, we send out notices about events that people might be interested in. For example, my chair just told me today that Robert George is coming in the fall, right, to give our Norton lecture. George is a very famous philosopher, and so a Catholic philosopher, and so it might be of interest to a lot of you, even folks from outside the university community. The sort of motive for this debate is that abortion is an extremely, it's an intrinsically interesting issue, but also it involves a whole lot of different basic philosophical questions. And the upside is you get a little introduction to a lot of interesting philosophical questions. The downside is I'm afraid we'll only be able to kind of skim the surface. But if you find it interesting and you find these questions worth your attention, let me just give a little plug for the philosophy department. That's what we do in the philosophy department. We discuss these often very difficult fundamental issues in a very rational, collegial kind of way. And for you students, I should add that our major is designed to be an easy double major, not easy in terms of the material, which is tremendously challenging, but easy in terms of there's no prerequisites. There's a lot of open sort of options for how to get the degree. So if you feel like majoring in philosophy, super. If you feel like double majoring, excellent. And we have over here our little requirements and courses for the fall. The structure of the debate is going to be rather informal. This is not going to be, you know, like a super structured debate. What we plan to do is start off with a coin toss to see who should go first, and then we'll each give maybe 10, 15 minutes basic sort of argument, and then have a few minutes, 5-7 minutes or so to respond to each other. And that should leave us loads of time for Q&A, which is, you know, I think really the most fun and the most interesting part. So, Richard has agreed. Toss the coin, because I was sure
now,
I would
really
drop it.
A choice, or are we just going to assign a first or sixth?
Oh, the difficult decisions.
Let's toss the coin on heads.
I'll take heads.
So heads for you,
heads
start
for
first, tails I start first.
All right.
Being the instigator of this restart, and thanks to Catholic Scholars and Philosophy Department for supporting us. Now, the title of the debate is Abortion Wrong? And that is a title that I want to chip away at a little bit to try to get more precise about some things.
for instance, there's a lot of things that people who are on both sides of the debate agree about. And there are some very common things that they disagree about. So I'm going to start by honing in on what it is that, that the real disagreement is. And first, I have very little use for terms like pro-life and pro-choice. Those are terms that are, those are names that are chosen for their rhetorical force, right? So if you choose the name pro-choice, then your opponent must be anti-choice. I mean, what kind of a monster could be anti-choice, right? And if you're pro-life, then that implies that your opponent is anti-life. What sort of a monster could be like that, right? So I don't want to talk in those terms, but there are definitely two different sides on the issue. And it's the issue that I want to get clear on first. So I think that the real disagreement in our society is over what to do about a certain proper subset of abortions that occur. And it's a very large proper subset of actual abortions. It's what I call early abortion on demand. That's the set of cases that I'm going to be focused on. And here's the idea. Early, I'm not going to try to define that, but for our purposes, we can just go with the Roe Court's first trimester. Okay? So you can understand me as talking about first trimester abortions. And what's the abortion part? Well, it has to be the deliberate termination of pregnancy. And what's the on-demand part? Well, in order to get clear on things, it's not that these cases don't matter, but they're actually peripheral to the central issue. So there are cases such as early abortion in response to pregnancy due to rape or something like that. I'm not counting those cases. There are cases where there's severe developmental abnormality in the fetus. I'm not counting those kinds of cases in early abortion on demand. There are cases where, of early abortion where it's to protect the mother's life. I'm not counting those cases of early abortion on demand. So I'm talking about developmentally normal fetuses, developmentally otherwise healthy pregnancies, no particular extra threat to the pregnant woman, and so on and so on and so on. And importantly, the pregnancy is the result of consensual intercourse in reasonable knowledge of the facts of life, where babies come from, all that kind of stuff, right? So the great majority of actual abortions in the United States are cases of early abortion on demand. First trimester, where it's roughly because the woman wants it, and, right? That's the basic idea. And it's that kind of case that there's real disagreement on. Now, I want to focus also, so that's sort of narrowing down the case of abortions. I also want to narrow down what is meant in my interest in the debate, what is meant by wrong here. So I'm going to focus on the claim that early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong. What does seriously wrong mean there? Well, let me give you an analogy, right? So here's my buddy Carl here, right? If I were to kill Carl right now, that would do him a great deal of harm. And if there's no sufficient overriding reason, it would be seriously wrong of me to do so. So murder of a typical adult human being like Carl is one of the things that we count as seriously wrong. So when one side says early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong, they mean something like we're dealing with the seriousness that's involved in me killing someone like Carl, right? Now, why does this make a difference? Well, you might think that early abortion on demand is sometimes wrong, right? Sometimes people say things like, well, I don't think you should use abortion as a form of contraception, or something like that, right? And maybe that's your view, and maybe it's true. But it's not clear that that's a claim of serious wrongness when you make it, right? So I'm going to define one side of the debate as claiming that early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong. And then the other side of the debate, the one that I'm inclined to defend, says that early abortion on demand is never seriously wrong. Now, once we get clear on what the terms are, then I think one of the benefits of having a discussion like this is that we can get out of the way some arguments that aren't really very good, and on both sides. Okay? So, for instance, sometimes you hear people on one side of the debate saying things like, well, look, you know, we should live and let live, right? You know, you might think abortion is wrong, but why should that affect my life, right? You know, live, just keep to our own little silos. And if you want an example of this kind of thing, in much of his rhetoric, Delaware's own Joe Biden says stuff that gets pretty close to this. Biden says things like, well, as a Catholic, of course, I believe that abortion is wrong, right? Now, notice he's not honing in on the early abortion on demand thing, but I'm pretty sure that if you were to push him, that's what he would say. Well, yes, I believe that early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong. But then he says, but I don't think that that should be public policy. What's odd about that is that it doesn't seem to take what I can call the conservative view here, the view that early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong, it doesn't take it seriously enough, right? Imagine that I said, oh yeah, you know, so, you know, this guy over here, you know, follower of Jeffrey Dahmer, you know, likes to take teenage boys back to his apartment, and when he's done with them, he kills them, you know, cuts them up, puts them in his freezer, that kind of stuff. But hey, you know, that's not my bag, but I don't get to tell him what to do, right? That's a crazy view, isn't it? Because although morality is not the, you know, it's not true that everything that's immoral should be illegal, right? Most of us think that adultery is immoral, but definitely shouldn't be illegal. But it's a matter of how seriously wrong the thing is. There is nobody who will say, well, yes, I think murder is seriously morally wrong, but I don't think it should be illegal. That's a crazy view. Seriously wrong, serious wrongness is an appropriate target of legal prohibition. Right? So if we're going to take the conservative view seriously, then we have to be fair to the conservative view, right? They are saying something, and we need to understand what the claim is and respond to it appropriately, and not just say, well, that's your view, go away, right? Now, what about on the other side of the coin? I think sometimes we don't take views seriously enough there either. Now, let me just ease you into this a little bit. Suppose that a pregnancy occurs, it's completely consensual, and so on, and so on, and so on, but there's a difference of opinion between the pregnant woman and the erstwhile father about what should happen to the pregnancy. Now, obviously, that difference of opinion could go two different ways, right? It could be that the woman wants to keep the baby to term, or it could be that the woman wants to abort. Now, I want you to imagine a general policy which said that, oh, well, it's the man who gets to say what happens to the pregnancy. I think a lot of Americans would go, what? Right? Really? A man gets to tell the woman what is going on in these circumstances? And notice, this is a man with some skin in the game, right? As the biological parent. Well, Now imagine that in place of the father, we have somebody who is a government instrumentality, who is now saying, we're going to make the rules for what you do with your body, right? That's a quite striking public policy claim. Now, maybe it can be justified, but again, I think you need to take the liberal view here seriously, that they regard that as an unacceptable intrusion into the private life of women. So what we have in the debate is two very, very weighty considerations on both sides. And so the first thing I want to say to you guys is give the other side credit for having weighty considerations that they care about, okay? Too often in our current climate, we just think that people who disagree with us are idiots, right? But reasonable people can disagree about these issues. How much longer?
Oh, you know, I wasn't timing you.
Oh! Then I've got 15.
Go for about 2 minutes. How about?
Since I was delayed, I have 15 more minutes, right? So. All right. So, I'll just say a couple more things and then
Sorry,
I'll wind
I
up.
Been.
Yeah, no, that's all right. So, take arguments seriously and be on the lookout for simple arguments that don't work, right? Another liberal argument that we should avoid making is, you know what? If we were to ban abortions, all abortions, then there will be more dangerous backyard abortions. Well, of course, that's fairly plausible. But by the same token, you know, suppose somebody says, you know, murder should be legal because if you make murder illegal, then there'll be all these dangerous backyard murders, you know. So again, if you think that early abortion on demand is always seriously wrong, you don't care that people are going to be safer committing this serious wrong if we don't make it legal. On the other side, a common argument that you hear is, look, if you, you know, because early abortion on demand, remember it's consensual intercourse, in reasonable knowledge of where babies come from and so on. Right, so sometimes you hear people say, you know, if you took the risk, if you had intercourse, even with protection, and you knew that it could happen, that you would get pregnant, then you are responsible for the pregnancy that results. Right? That's a common kind of argument that you hear. Now, two things. One claim is, whether it follows as any sort of general principle that if you undertake any risk whatsoever, then you're responsible for the results, right? You might think that's not very plausible. And secondly, even if you agree that you are responsible, that by itself doesn't tell you what you ought to do. Right? Usually people giving this argument mean that the only responsible thing is to carry the pregnancy to term. But that seems to me question begging. It's only your responsibility to carry the pregnancy to term if it would be wrong for you to terminate, right? So I want to hear more. I want to hear, why is it the responsible thing to carry to term? Maybe it's responsible to make a quick and informed decision, and that can include early abortion on demand. So I'll stop there. Thank you, Kate.
Well, I appreciate Rich, that's not mine. I don't know where that came from. I brought my water, of course. I appreciate Richard sort of setting things up, especially the point about respecting the other person's point of view. I'm going to go ahead and defend the sort of what I call the basic, I'm going to call it the pro-life position, just because, and the other position, the pro-choice position, just because that's what the adherents have labeled themselves. I always figure, you know, you want to be called Jerome, you know, I'll call you Jerome, because that's what you want to be called. So, but they're, you know, Richard is right, they're just rhetorical labels. What I want to do again is just to give sort of the basic, there's really, I think, one basic pro-life argument, and, you know, there might be all sorts of different variations on that main argument, but, you know, I'll just sort of try to lay out a quick sketch of it. and maybe anti-couple things. I think we've established that it would just be wrong to kill Carl. Now, Richard said a couple of things I disagree with. One was that the main issue nowadays is early abortion. I think in the news, the main issue now is late-term abortions. But the other thing I might want to question is that Carl is typical. But I think we can all agree that it would be a mistake. People who know Carl are laughing in the heart of that it would be a mistake to kill him. It would be a mistake, it would be a terrible thing just to kill any of you. Why? Well, there's different ways you can put the why. This is one of those enormous questions of philosophy that we can barely touch on. You might put it in terms of the human being, the adult human being has a tremendous value such that it would just be a terrible shame to destroy that thing. You might put it in terms of rights. You might put it in terms of interests. I think my inclination is to kind of go all of the above. But I presume that we can all agree that it would be wrong for me just to kill one of you. Arguments about that? No, good. So the basic pro-life argument goes like this. Look, right now, as you sit here in Chard Lab, you're the kind of thing that it would just be terrible to kill. Well, when you were a baby, you were very different from the way you are now. You were a whole lot smaller. You didn't have nearly the same physical or cognitive or linguistic abilities that you have now. But I think most of us agree that it's terribly wrong to kill babies and small children. That you, as you sit here now, are the same living organism that you were as a baby or a small child, that there's a continuous development between the time you were a baby and as you sit here now, such that I think it's legitimate to say if you're a person as you sit here now, you were a person as a baby. Now, I want to underline that I'm using person as a term of art. All I mean when I say person in this context is this entity is the kind of thing that it would be wrong to kill for roughly the same reasons it would be wrong to kill any one of you. That's all I mean by a person. But I take it that most of us think that just as the adult is a very valuable sort of thing and should not be killed, that the baby is a very valuable thing and should not be killed. And if there's a continuity, you were that baby, even though you don't remember it, even though certainly have different sorts of thoughts and ideas than you had a long time ago. Nonetheless, that was you. So then the argument goes, well, look, the living organism that is sitting here now, that living human organism, began at conception. Couple of hundred years ago, I think people didn't think that. You might have heard the term quickening, and that's what it means nowadays is the time when the mother begins to be able to feel the baby. It's like you've got this little butterfly inside. It's real weird. And it's about 4 months from conception. And in the old days, they used to think, well, gee, maybe that's when the baby comes to life. And before that, it was some kind of inert sort of growing thing or something. Nowadays, of course, science teaches us that the original zygote just develops continuously all that time and, you know, is eventually born as a newborn and then grows into you. And so the claim is, well, look, it's the same organism that developed continuously from conception. There really is no good place to try to draw some kind of a line. So if the issue is the sort of nature or status of the fetus, then it makes sense to say the fetus is a person as much as you and I are. Add to that the thought that, I feel like I'm going to say shocking things here. Being pregnant, so the first claim is, look, it really does make sense to give this fetus really serious moral status. Second claim, being pregnant just isn't that bad. Having been pregnant 4 times, 3 cesareans, I mean, I grant it's, you know, it's really uncomfortable. You know, those last couple of weeks are just like, oh no, I gotta have this baby. But it isn't, I think a lot of people, especially, you know, people who haven't been around a lot of babies and pregnant women and whatnot, think that being pregnant is somehow a dread disease. And, you know, that will keep you from doing, you know, how can I go to school if I'm pregnant? Well, you know, you have to sit in a different chair. So just being pregnant is a temporary discomfort. And towards the end, you know, last couple of weeks, it's a big discomfort. But nonetheless, it's temporary. So, you know, I don't want to, and a lot of people will say, well, but look, the issue isn't literally the being pregnant. It's the having to take care of the child. As far as I know, there is not a state in the union that requires you to take care of that child. You can put that baby up for adoption. You are never required, if you honestly believe that it is just beyond your capacity, you don't have friends or family who can help you out, you can put that child up for adoption. So you can't, in terms of the issue, is it wrong to have an abortion? You can't, I think, factor in the problems with looking after the child later, because that doesn't really necessarily weigh in the issue. And I want to add, and Richard didn't think this was a plausible argument, and of course it isn't plausible unless you're willing to allow the thought that the fetus is or may be a real person with moral standing like you or I. But if you think that it's reasonable to think that the fetus really is a person or may well be a person, then the thought that you deliberately, knowingly took the action that you knew might bring this little person into existence, I mean, it seems to me that that would lead to you having some kind of responsibility for that little person. You owe that little person because you're the one that took the action, with some help, of course, all by yourself. I think that's the basic pro-life argument. There's a lot of pro-choice arguments down the years, but all different kinds of pro-choice arguments. So I just want to mention a few briefly, and these are not Richard's arguments. I just throw these out as examples of arguments that are really probably kind of silly and don't need to be responded to, but just as examples. So for example, on the fetus is not a person side of things, there's basically two ways to go. You can say, look, the fetus really shouldn't be considered a person. It doesn't have moral status. Or you can say, well, maybe it does. It's a person, it's got moral status, it's still okay to kill it. And so you have both of those kinds of on the Peter System to Person side, one time on this very campus, that there was a guy, he was an abortionist who was traveling around the country showing a movie about what a great guy he was for performing abortions. So, you know, I asked, you know, and so why is it that you think that the fetus, you know, doesn't have any moral standing? And it was so weird, because it's like, he hadn't even thought of this question. And it took him a long time to come up with an answer. And his answer was, but the fetus is very small. No, really, as he was thinking about the early abortion, it's really small. Now, Richard and I disagree about a lot, but we agree on some things, and I'm betting, you know, we're not going to argue about whether or not size is really what would give you your moral status. My youngest granddaughter is now 5 weeks old, and she's a whole lot littler than her two-year-old cousin, and both of them put together are way smaller than this thing. But that certainly would not mean that somehow they are lacking in moral standing. It's very bizarre. In terms of the, yes, it's a person, but it's okay to kill it. Just briefly, a couple of examples. One argument that one heard for a while there was that, you know, if all of a sudden, I'm sure this won't happen, but if all of a sudden one of you jumped up and ran down to attack me with a knife, it would be okay for me to use deadly violence to kill you, to stop you, to save myself, right? And the fetus is just like an attacker who is attacking you, and therefore abortion is okay. Another one, and this one was from a Delaware legislator, was if you could only explain to the fetus why it's important that he be allowed to be killed, he'd be happy to be killed. He'd want to be killed. And as Richard said, there are silly, you know, you can have silly pro-life arguments too. What if they killed Jesus before he was ever born? Well, what if they killed Hitler before he was ever born? So, there are silly arguments on both sides. Let's grant that. One more thing I want to add. Before the debate, I thought, well, I should see if there have been any sort of big developments in the world of philosophy about, you know, the issue. So, you know, I didn't have a lot of time, but I looked up a little bit. And one of the issues that seems to be of interest to people lately, more than in the past, is the question of harm, the harm that an abortion does to the woman, to the one having the abortion. And apparently, there are a lot of studies that show that abortion causes psychological trauma and might lead to alcoholism or drug addiction. Now, I'm not saying that this is a reason to outlaw abortion. I mean, Richard was right that there you should, you know, the government maybe has to stand back and let people hurt themselves. The reason abortion should be illegal is that it's killing very small children without justification. But I think it's worthwhile adding that there's evidence that it harms women. Now, people debate that research. They say, look, the studies weren't well designed. The conclusions didn't really follow from the evidence that you found in the studies. So, you know, in terms of science, I think we do have to leave it kind of an open question in terms of actual research. And of course, it's such a politicized issue, it's going to be hard to get good research. But I want to say just in terms of sort of personal experience, having known women who have kept their babies, having known women who've had abortions, let me try this on you, and of course you'll just have to see what you think. I assume that most of us want to believe that we are loving people who care for others. And people why it's okay to kill a person, even if he is a person. And in your heart, you're still gonna feel like, at least you're gonna have that suspicion that that was your baby and you killed it, and I think you're gonna be miserable. And again, I'm not, you know, the evidence is mixed because the studies are open to question. You know, the alternative would be to kind of harden yourself and not worry about it, but perhaps it doesn't really do you any good to be the sort of person who hardens yourself and doesn't worry about such things. So, I want to argue the fetus is a person, and I realize it's kind of an extreme view, but from conception, and abortion probably hurts women, and therefore it is should be illegal because it's killing unjustifiably, and it's just wrong.
How long do I have this time?
About 5 to 7.
5 to 7, all right.
So. 5 to 7, and then we'll have questions.
Okay. Okay, thanks, Kay. There was a lot in there. The reason I say that early abortion on demand is the issue, it's true that in terms of state legislatures around the place, there's a lot of debate over late-term abortion bills now. But the reason that I'm not focusing on cases like that is that there can be considerable agreement about those cases between the two pro-choice and pro-life sides. If you take Roe v. Wade on its face, then in third trimester, states are, in certain circumstances, permitted to regulate or prohibit abortion, right? So you might well find people who will call themselves pro-choice who are in favor of limiting late-term abortion. That's why I think that that's not the heart of the issue. I'll come back to the moral status of the fetus thing, because that's where the rubber meets the road here. I just want to put together a couple of other points that Kate made. So one is the pregnancy is really cool, you know. So good.
And
no, I mean in your experience, is that fair? So
it's not that bad. It's not like
right,
having a dread disease.
Okay, pregnancy is not that bad. And put that together with the claims at the end about, you know, there is some mixed empirical evidence about the psychological harms to women who have abortions. Of course, it's a really interesting question why there are those psychological harms, right? And it might be that, you know, in part it's the substantial stigma that they receive from certain parts of society that contributes to bad feelings about that. So, you know, there's all sorts of interesting questions there, but it seems to me that, again, I think on those issues, we don't need to decide the empirical issues. We can bring them together and make a recommendation that I think Kate and I both agree on, which is abortion should be relatively rare. Right? So the pro-choice people, and I'm happy to use the term pro-choice in the strict of its rhetorical force, so What we want, right, you don't have to think that abortion is just this wonderful, cool thing that, you know, that women should just be, yes, please, sign me up, right? Can't wait to get my next one. It's perfectly compatible with the pro-choice position that abortion is something that's very difficult and has consequences for the woman, right? It doesn't follow from that that it's wrong. And so I'm all for taking the condition of post-abortion women seriously and giving the support they need and so on and so on and so on. But since it's something that can be bad for the woman, let's keep it rare. That would be good. The main disagreement, I think, between us is whether it should be safe and legal. So, all right. By the way, I don't think the main worry that women have when they choose abortion is over whether or not they'll have to look after the child. I just don't think that's the main issue. That's why in my introduction I said we should take the fact that somebody is
you know, it's potentially telling the woman what she has to do with her body. That's far more important, I think, to those who are on the pro-choice side. It's not a question of what happens to the child in the future. So I like to say, you know, think of what we call pregnancy in Victorian times, right? Confinement, right? I think that for a woman who doesn't want to be pregnant, it is a kind of confinement to force that woman to be pregnant. Right? It's not the same as locking them up in prison, but it is a significant reduction of their autonomy. And that's what I want you to take seriously. That doesn't by itself settle the issue, but we need to take it seriously. All right, so I'm going to, because I don't have much time, I'm going to skip over the you owe the little person point because of the choice that you made. I just think that's question begging, but we can come back to that if anybody has any questions. So let's get to the moral status of the fetus part. So I agree that there are all sorts of places to draw lines that are utterly indefensible. Right? So size, obviously irrelevant. Whether the child is inside or outside the womb cannot possibly affect the moral status of the thing. Right? That's an arbitrary place to draw a line. If we're drawing the line on the basis of the moral status of the thing in question. But equally arbitrary, it seems to me, are things like the beginning of a fetal heartbeat. So what, right? If you, you know, I want to hear, why does that matter to the moral status of the thing? And you talked about size in this thing here. Well, this thing lacks a heartbeat, okay. But there are plenty of other things that have heartbeats that we have no trouble killing at all, right? So we need to be we need to be cautious about drawing our own lines if we think that other lines are going to be arbitrary and unimportant. So what kind of other line can a person draw? Well, this may have slipped by you, but I was listening. So what Kate said was, you are the same living organism as that. And of course, we often talk in this way, right? So we often say things like, well, you know, when I was, you know, a first trimester fetus, blah, 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 blah. But, well, no, I mean, we don't quite say that, but, you know, but our mom will say, oh, when you were in the womb, you know, before you were kicking and blah, blah, blah. So, you know what I mean? We talk in that way. Notice, we also say things like, oh, we buried him yesterday, right? And a lot of you don't want to take that literally, right? You'll be saying, well, what we buried was a dead body, but that wasn't Ralph, right? You know, Ralph's in heaven or something like that, right? So we shouldn't take our ordinary talk about where we apply the term you or them or me too seriously. We want some principled reason. Now, is there some principle to drawing the line at conception? Well, yes, right? The argument would go roughly something like, until conception, you don't have something that has the full human genetic code or something like that, right? So that's obviously a more principled place than some others to draw the line. But, of course, it's not in dispute. No pro-choicer who's worth their salt is going to dispute that from conception you have a living human organism. The entire question is how to regard that thing. And the fact is, sorry Carl, it's you again, right? So, right? Just here's, and again, this is too short a time to solve this problem, but let me throw up some issues here, right? Now, I'll bet that many of you think that if I were to kill Carl, the victim would be Carl, the person, right? That's the thing that is really harmed by the killing. That's the thing that has this moral status. But what kind of thing is that? And is it identical with a living human organism. I bet a lot of you think that cow is not identical with a living human organism. You hold some kind of dualist view, right? According to which cow can die, that's cow's body can die, but cow can move on, right? If you have that kind of view, then it's an utterly open question when cow came into existence, right? Because if your view is cow is a different thing from the living human organism, then so far the argument just establishes that there's something around. But if that's not the victim of the killing in cow's case, why would it be an important victim of the killing in the case of a fetus?
Okay, well, a couple of things to say. I'm a little worried about Professor Handley's characterization of Rosers' wave, because in fact, in the third trimester, what it says is the state may prevent abortion, except in cases where the health or the life of the mother is at issue. And then in a sister case, the sides at the same time, Doe versus Bolton, the Supreme Court deliberately decided that health should be understood very, very broadly to include emotional health, financial health. In Doe versus Bolton, the issue was a woman who felt like she could not look after a fourth child, and the word abortion does not come up, the word adoption does not appear in Doe versus Bolton. Roe v. Wade, five to four, overturned the laws of all 50 states, even the most liberal states, even California and New York. And moreover, I don't know if you noticed, but last summer in Delaware, the law in Delaware used to be that in the third trimester, you needed two medical doctors or a medical doctor and a physician to sign on to a third trimester abortion, because it's a pretty major kind of a thing, the third trimester. And also you needed to show the woman an ultrasound, and presumably part of the reasoning at least is, it is this major thing, so you want a genuinely informed decision. And the legislature of Delaware overturned both of those. The only person who has to sign on is the abortionist, and we're not going to show the woman any ultrasound. But she better not be informed. And the argument was, we're just codifying Roe v. Wade, and they're right about that. Now the states that are beginning to allow infanticide, I think Roe v. Wade doesn't necessarily entail infanticide. But the other point to emphasize is that you notice Professor Handley didn't really address the question of when, if ever, we might decide that between conception and thank you for saying conception is a principal place to draw a line. But Professor Handley didn't suggest where one might draw a line. Here's a principled philosophical place where it seems to me many philosophers do draw that line, and it's something like this. The person doesn't really come into being until they're able to have a fairly elevated cognitive abilities. One way of saying it would be, look, you don't really have moral interests until you're the kind of thing that is able to sort of recognize their own moral interests, or to have plans for the future that might be interrupted. And so a small child just doesn't count as part of the moral community. The problem obviously is, yes, you do leave out the fetus, and that, if you're hoping to defend abortion, that's a good move. But you do leave out infants and small children, and any view that includes leaving out infants and small children for the same reasons that you justify abortion seems to be saying that it is legitimate if we find infants and small children burdensome or one way or another, we want to get rid of them, that's legitimate. On the table over here, I have a couple of pages out of Roe v. Wade that just explains what the position is, and it has a page for Doe versus Bolton that gives the business about how health means almost anything. And at the end, I have an article from the past, but not the whole article, just the first page in case you wanted to look up the whole article, and the conclusion, where Richard Hanley is defending the thought that, should I say?
Go for it.
I'll read you this last paragraph. Have you changed your mind since then?
Have I changed my mind since then? No.
Okay. Well, here's the last paragraph. The paper is called A Modest Proposal, and you can look up the whole thing, Public Affairs Quarterly. Here's the
Please
last
do.
Paragraph. Notice what's going on. The argument is going to be that only something above a certain cognitive threshold should be considered a person, and therefore, since the person-centered interest in survival outweighs the interests of a known non-person, and he's including fetuses and babies and small children, let the at-risk poor kill and eat their unwanted fetuses and babies. Consider also that we who grow to maturity in the developed world are far more ecologically expensive than the often enough undernourished denizens of the developing world. Given the principle of diminishing marginal utility and the extravagance of our lifestyle, there's an obvious ecological argument that our unwanted babies and fetuses are asymmetrically replaceable. So wherever practical, let them, that is the poor, eat our unwanted babies and fetuses. Now that sounds pretty gross, but it, there's the yuck factor. It is a principled position. If you think that, fetuses and babies and small children, are the sorts of things that it's legitimate to kill and throw away, then, why not say it's legitimate to kill them and put them to some good use by eating them? So I think Richard and I both have what can be called sort of extreme and principled positions.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Do I get a minute?
Okay.
Yep. No, can I just get a minute to?
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Let me get my water.
just one thing. There's a big if in front of that whole thing, which is kind of important, right? So that whole article is written from a certain point of view, namely the point of view of a philosopher named Peter Singer, somebody who I have tremendous respect for. And what I'm pointing out in that article is that if you take his views on the correct treatment of animals and his views on the correct treatment of human beings, and you put them together, then you get this result. Right? So that was the argument that I made in that paper. And I left it open how people might respond to that, right? One response is to go, well, obviously that's wrong, so there must be something wrong with Singer's view, right? But I explicitly reserved judgment on which way anybody should respond to that. Now, I do think that Singer's overall views are pretty hard to rebut, right? So I don't think it's a crazy view to also look at it the other way and say, well, this actually follows. Now, before you rush off and say, well, that's not only infanticide, but why waste the product? the one thing I should say is that in Singer's own view, although he does not think that newborn infants are people, right? They don't have full moral standing, the same moral standing that you and I do. He nevertheless thinks that many cases of infanticide would be seriously wrong because, if you go busting into the maternity ward and kill all the newborn infants in there, you'll be doing a great deal of harm to people who put enormous investment into those little kids. It's just if you painlessly kill a newborn infant, you do
do it no direct harm. That is the view. And the fact is, ethics is hard. It's a matter of balancing interests here and there, values here and there, and trying to come up with a consistent and coherent position. So
Can we throw it open to Q&A? Yes,
we can throw it open to Q&A. Yes.
I guess we should both just stand up here.
Yeah, why not?
For Professor Hanley, two related things. It was on the where you draw the line.
Yes.
It was said that the line came that you, or the argument that you laid out came was a continuum of causation and from conception that individualism causes first trimester, second trimester, infant, adult. So, if first question. That there is that continuum of causation. And then the second is if you believe that that is not a valid argument for saying that the living normalism act conception is the same understanding as you right now, why? And then if you think that is not a valid argument, what would you provide as an alternative definition? Draw the line, at what point does that continuum of causation that we call an organism have more standing than adult?
Okay. Well, the first part is it was kind of implied in my discussion with Carl earlier. I don't think Carl is identical with any living human organism. Right. That's not my view. There is a living organism over there, and that is not Carl. Carl is a different.
Because there's more other
than. But it's still wrong to kill that body that is not Carl.
If you, here's the crucial question: what would be the victim of the killing? Right. Standard view: the person, Carl. Right. So Carl is the. If I think Carl would be the victim of the killing, I don't think Carl is a living human organism. So the fact that there is a living human organism over there. That is killed, that is continuous with something that began, that maybe began at conception. There are other ways that you might unpack that, but that doesn't tell you anything about.
So what point is that
so what
about what would happen?
At what point does a victim occur?
When do victims of killings emerge? Well, that's an excellent question, right? So, a couple of different options. One is going the Singer route. So, in Singer's view, in order to have a person, it's a necessary condition that there be an individual with a self-concept. That's one kind of view that's in the literature. Another kind of view is it's even later than that. You don't have a fully fledged person until you have something that's a moral agent. Right, that's a roughly Kantian view. Another sort of view you find in the literature is some people say you don't need self-consciousness, but when consciousness emerges, and consciousness here entails, amongst other things, the capacity to suffer and enjoy. So if something can feel pain, then it would count, and so on, and so on, and so on. Now, I'm inclined to a view that you don't get full membership in the moral community until you're a moral agent. I'm inclined to that kind of view. But what follows from that? Well, it doesn't mean that anything before that has no moral value at all, right? So what you find is something like the Roe decision is sensitivity to disagreement between reasonable people, especially later, about what could be going on. And most people think, and this is exactly what the Roe decision says, is that by the time of third trimester, given the facts about human development, it's a completely reasonable view to hold that that definitely is something that has moral standing, and so that states can then reasonably take action to regulate or prohibit abortion. So any philosopher worth their salt who takes the kind of view that I have is going to say, well, look, you know, an acorn isn't an oak tree, but a young oak tree is a hell of a lot more like an oak tree than it is like an acorn, and so on, right? So you have a developmental continuum.
and you take the thing more seriously the older that it gets.
That's the kind of thing that I have. But I think first trimester, 6 weeks, heartbeat, I don't think there is a
If I asked you where to draw the line between bald and not bald, right? That's an old philosophical conundrum, right? It's a vague matter, right? It's philosophically vague. That's just the nature of the beast. So I'm not going to say, oh, it's a 6 months or something like that. What I'm giving you is it's definitely earlier than Carl's age, and it's definitely later than the end of the first trimester. Everything else is negotiable.
Okay, so my question goes directly towards Professor Hodges. So you spoke on before about adoption and like the foster system as a whole. So would you say this is a follow-up question, depending on your answer, but would you say that the that abortion morally is better than putting a child through the foster care system?
Oh no. No. I would say abortion is worse, right? I mean, my whole argument is, I mean, if you had a 2-year-old and, you know, her parents died, you wouldn't kill her rather than put her in the foster care, right? I mean, needless to say, one wants the best foster care system possible or preferably, you know, just full adoption by loving parents. But, I mean, my thinking is that, you know, the fetus, I mean, basically has the same moral status as you, or the small child.
So, I have like a couple statistics and then we'll follow up. So
statistics, tamblies.
Yeah, I'm following like a Kantian science and
statistics.
So, after the age of 18, 20% of children in foster care will become homeless, meaning that out of the 23,000 children that are going to the foster care system this year, about 4,600 will become
homeless.
In addition, less than 3% of foster children have any possibility of going to college. 25% of foster children suffer from PTSD from the system itself. 60% of foster children go to prison, in addition to having an 80% of recidivism rate, and so on and so forth. So, on a relating this back to like our class, would you say that this that abortion is worse, still systematically, is worse than systematically preventing a child from reaching success and becoming a moral agent? And would you say there afterwards, in addition, that it prevents someone from
reaching success? I mean, needless to say, those are very, you know, troubling statistics. But, you know how there are guys all around Newark who claim to be homeless? I mean, if you just decided that was so terrible that they're better off dead, you could just drive around Newark and shoot him, right? But you wouldn't do that, right? Because you think it's really better, you know, even though they're, you know, seem to be living very unhappy lives, it's better, you know, you don't have any business killing them, right? And so, I mean, my argument is abortion is killing, you know, a person, and, you know, of course you want to try to do the best for those people, but even if someone is likely not to lead a happy life, I don't think you would assume that would justify just killing them.
And notice too, I mean, there are lots of countries where people have just the sort of prospects that you described, and we don't, you know, it's just, oh, let's just go kill the kids, you know. So, yeah, I mean, you know, it sounds pretty monstrous when you put it that way.
I think plenty over here. And then she saw an ultrasound and suddenly realized to cheat for some reason, and you know, who knows how many people were like this, but she just hadn't had the advantages of a good education. And so she had honestly believed that the fetus was not, it was just a clump of cells or something like that. And she found seeing the ultrasound, you know, very informative. My assumption is that the reason you want to show the ultrasound is that you, especially that late in the pregnancy, when the fetus is, you know, essentially just the same as a baby who gets born, you want the one, if she's going to make that decision, you want her to understand what it is she's doing and not find out 2 years later and then be crushed.
Can I have a quick thing on that? There are three possible policies here. Force the pregnant woman to view ultrasounds and things like that. Prevent them from ever seeing ultrasounds like that, or allow them the choice of seeing this, and I would go for that third option.
But I mean, and see, I would say, well, you know, you don't, when you're having like your wisdom teeth out, you know, they make you, you know, look at the instruction, they make you look at what the possibility, the doctor has to sit you down and talk to you about what the, you know, what might happen. So, you know, I'm going to say, you know, you really do, you know, if it's a major surgical operation, the thought that, well, we can, you know, you can find out if you're interested, but we're not going to, you know, insist that you understand, then, you know, to me that just seems wrong.
I don't go here.
That's right.
I went to Villanova, and then I went to Georgetown for med school. So two good Catholic universities. And now I'm an OBGYN here. So I just wanted to point out a couple science-based things that maybe we should talk about in this conversation. So evidence shows, studies after studies show, that pregnancy has higher morbidity and mortality than abortions.
I'm interested about the statistics because, you know, you're always hearing about women being rushed from the abortion clinic to the hospital. In the hospital, would they say the woman died of abortion, or would they say she died of hemorrhaging or this or that? You know, I'm just wondering how the statistics are compiled. The woman, and the notice, I mean, the law has sort of an educational purpose. says it's okay, morally it really is okay. So, I think a woman could honestly believe that it was okay, but that doesn't really address the philosophical question. Is it really okay?
I think actually women have a lot more of a philosophical basis for their decision making because they give them credit for it. So they are able to weigh their values and determine. I actually have a lot of patients who do actually see their own pregnancies as living things and can weigh that against the necessary termination of the pregnancy.
Necessary because.
When the acorn becomes an oak tree, but isn't it the case that you're definitely either killing an oak tree or you're not at any stage of development? My own view of vagueness is that no, it's not the case that it's always definitely true that you are or you aren't. There's only one view of vagueness that is rather unpopular that has that result. But let me instead move away from that technical philosophical point to something. Right. So here's the way that, I look at this as a public policy matter, right? So what we have is reasonable people disagreeing about the status of early fetuses. And the problem that the government has is how to respond to that in terms of public policy. And it looks on the surface like what they've done is said, oh, the liberals are right, the pro-choice people are right. But I don't think that's what happened at all, right? So in the Roe decision, what the judge has said is, who are we to say which of these camps is right? Right? And they shouldn't be saying that, right? So they then have a balancing act, right? You have reasonable people on both sides disagreeing about the moral status of the early fetus, and I understand their view, and I would defend their decision by saying, look, what you're balancing is certain harms to a known person versus possible harms to a thing that some people think is a person and other people think is not. And I think that it's a perfectly respectable balancing there to go with the, to give the known person the benefit of the doubt.
So I have to respond. Thing one is, copies of the decision in Roe v. Wade right there, the state must permit abortions for the mother doesn't have to give any kind of reason in the first two trimesters. In the third trimester, the state may ask the mother to give reasons, but any reason will do if she argues that her finances will be harmed, if she in emotional distress, if she argues that her emotions will suffer, then any reason will do. So the thought that Roe v. Wade just came down on the side of abortion for any reason up until the point of birth, I think is right there in black and white. Second thing to say is that suppose for the sake of argument, and I'm not granting this, okay, but for the sake of argument, it's really an open question what the moral status of the fetus is. Questions about risk-taking and how you decide on risks are very difficult. That's one of the great issues in philosophy. You take some philosophy courses and you can really get into it. One way to assess risk is to say, well, whatever's the case, let's try to avoid the worst possibility. If we're saying that the fetus might be a person, you know, with full moral status as much as Carl, then the worst possibility is we've murdered this person. So suppose we don't assess risk that way. How about to try this and see what you think? The woman, of course, is, you know, a full person. No one's having any, you know, doubt about that, and she has a right to bodily autonomy. I mean, that's extremely important. So, you know, let's give her, I don't know, 100 points for her bodily autonomy. So she should have the abortion. But the argument is the fetus might be a person. It might not, but it might be a person. Well, if it might be, then maybe, you know, it's got its interest in bodily autonomy too. So we ought to give it a few points for, you know, possibly being a person. So it's got a few points for bodily autonomy. But also, the fetus, if it's a person, then the question is its life. Now maybe it's not a person, on the hypothesis. But if we're interested in its weighing, you know, possibilities, it's got this interest in its life, in addition to its autonomy. And so we should give it a few more points. We don't know whether or not in final analysis in general, in terms of solid scientific research, abortion actually benefits or harms women, so that's a washout. But, you know, it seems like if you allow the possibility that the fetus is a person, even if we're saying, you know, we're just not sure, maybe it is, maybe it isn't, the interest in autonomy and life, even if it's only the possibility, is going to outweigh the interest that the woman undoubtedly, with nobody questioning it, has in her bodily autonomy. So I think even if we say, look, we just, I mean, and again, I'm not granting this. I'm just saying, you know, suppose, like the Supreme Court, you know, we don't know whether this thing is really a person, but it's okay, don't for any reason up until it's, you know, finished being born. You know, I'm gonna say even if it very well might be a person, the cost-benefit analysis, the risk assessment should still be in favor of the woman carrying that baby to term. I think this fellow had his hand up for a long time.
Yeah.
So, my question is directed towards Professor Eric Hamlin. You said that the main argument of the pro-choice movement is regarding the rights of the woman to choose and make a choice, correct? That is the larger problem.
That's a fair characterization, yeah.
Personally, I believe that in a liberal society, we should move towards granting people as close to as much liberty as possible. So I feel like that is an entirely valid line of reasoning. However, if I feel like there comes a conflict of interest in terms of providing, under the current standing of the law, in how the child is taken care of after birth, it makes it difficult to permit I believe you characterized early. Sorry, I can't remember if it's early abortion.
Early fetus or early infant? I'm not sure which you are after.
Early abortion on demand.
Early abortion, okay, sorry.
So, by granting the liberty entirely to the following conception, up until the point of conception, the choice of conceiving a child is distributed equally between the man and the woman. Following conception, if you were to provide the woman with the option to have an abortion, which I feel is within the grounds and responsibility of a liberal society to grant her her bodily autonomy, you also have the issue that if she is pregnant and desires to carry the child to term while the man in the relationship does not, the man in the relationship is now under obligation and compulsion by the state to care for a child that he had no willingness to conceive. And this is problematic because this would fundamentally be granting autonomy to one party, or granting more liberty to one party while infringing upon the autonomy of another.
Yeah, so we don't even need to worry about autonomy especially here, but this is a really interesting moral question, right? If you are the male and you don't want the child brought to term, you might well question whether you in fact have any moral responsibility for that child if the woman decides to keep it. Now, as a matter of fact, our laws are such that you do have responsibility. And if you were going to defend this morally, the only way to defend it, I think, is as a case of moral luck. Sometimes morality has consequences for people because you're just in the wrong place at the wrong time. And that is, the only possible defense of that. You're just going to have to wear it along with other cases of moral luck. But if somebody wants to go in the opposite direction and say, no, that's our principle, we should get rid of that law, I don't think that would be unreasonable.
So it's fair to say that you would willingly reject the responsibility of the father to the child if he had no desire to...
What I'm saying is I think there are reasonable cases to be made either way. Yeah. You've already had a go, so is there anyone who hasn't had a go yet? Yep, out the back. Yes.
You said that the heartbeat isn't really all the heartbeat said, so it doesn't matter.
I'm saying from a moral point of view, there doesn't seem anything non-arbitrary about the presence of a heartbeat.
We tell other things that have heartbeats. But those other things are animals. Don't you think that animals and humans may be different, or are they the same?
In terms of, let me throw a question back at you, right? So suppose that it turned out, you probably tell I'm not from around here from my accent, right? Suppose it turned out they did a new study and they found that genetically the occupants of Australia are not human.
Right?
We knew it. Okay. We know closer to you guys than chimpanzees or something like that, right? Do you think that now, any universal declaration of human rights wouldn't apply to us? I hope your answer is Australians would still be covered, right? Because there's a broader sense of human which is not connected with membership of the biological species. Roughly, it's, you know, we in philosophy call it moral humanity, right? So you're morally human if you have the same sort of standing as you're not from Australia right now. Okay, let's go. Yes.
Why not use the hunter's rule when it does?
The which?
I said, why not use the hunter's rule?
Oh, they sing in the bushes. Yeah, that was Kate's argument. Why not? Because I think, here's a couple of disanalogies with that case, right? So Francis Beckwith is an example.
What is the hunter's rule?
Yes, yeah. So Francis Beckwith says, look, if you're out hunting and there's, say, you know, suppose there was a 20% chance that there was a human being in the bush over there, right? Should you shoot into the bush or should you refrain from shooting into the bush? Easy question, right? You should refrain from shooting into the bush. Everybody agree? Okay. And then he uses that as an analogy with the case of abortion, right? Now, first of all, here are two important disanalogies. Disanalogy one is that there is, you know, there's an obvious thing to do. If you really want to shoot into that bush, then you just need to get closer and make sure that there's no human being in it, right? So you're in a situation that's epistemically non-ideal, right? You don't know stuff that you really could know just by getting closer. When we're making public policy on the abortion issue, it's not a matter of, oh, we're just waiting for more evidence to come in or something like that. No, the genuine disagreement is on metaphysical and moral grounds, and that's not something that getting closer is going to help you to settle. So that's a disanalogy. The second disanalogy is, it is almost no cost to the hunter to refrain from shooting into that bush, right? So even if you really love hunting, right? Whereas, you know, this is what I want people to take seriously about the pro-choice side of the argument. I claim it's an enormous cost to a woman to force her to carry to term a pregnancy that she does not want to carry to term. And so I think when you weigh the things properly, then the risk comes out in the opposite direction of the way that Beckwith and Kate.
I disagree, but it's 8:30, which is the official